KCAA Loma Linda, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and now 102.3 FM.
Welcome to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal. Today's show is brought to you by Place Your Bet. If you like to bet on sports games, the NFL, Major League Baseball, the NHL, and the NBA, even college football, and you're looking for a real bettor's edge on the casino sportsbook, call Place Your Bet right now, 702-799-9935, and subscribe. Place Your Bet uses money movement to determine its picks, just like the casino odds makers. In fact, they're the guys the casino don't want you to know about. Call Place Your Bet right now, 702-799-9935, and subscribe or visit them online at placeyourbet.vegas. Get winners and cash tickets today with Place Your Bet. And a big welcome back to everybody tuning in on our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates from coast to coast, as well as those watching on AMP TV and KHMP television right here in Las Vegas, as well as those listening on Spotify and iHeartRadio. Right from the top of the show, I believe we have a special guest. Let's go ahead and bring him in and let him introduce himself. That would be you, young man.
That is me, Riki Ellison. I'm here.
Riki Ellison. All right, Riki, thanks for joining us today. That would be the three-time Super Bowl champion, Riki Ellison, also the national champion from the University of Southern California. Thanks for joining us today, Riki.
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right, so what's Riki up to these days?
Well, I just hosted a panel discussion in the U.S. Capitol with our Undersecretary of Defense for Policy on our status of the United States missile defense capabilities.
Wow.
Around the world.
Holy smokes. Tell us more.
Well,
I mean, you get not the classified stuff, of course. But
I think we're all aware of the drone attack that happened this weekend on Saudi Arabia, and we're aware that that threat is going to continue to proliferate around the world. It's a very not complex capability that's being demonstrated by Iran through a proxy state. So being able to defend oil fields or airports, et cetera, are critically important right now to stabilize the environment over there.
Right, right. How'd you get involved in that, Riki?
Way back 30 years ago, I was at USC playing football, and I got a couple knee surgeries playing, and I was redirected my course loads and got into a classroom of Governor Ronald Reagan's National Security Advisor, a guy named Dr. Bill Van Cleve, a Marine, who was on some previous negotiations with the Russians, and introduced me to Star Wars before it was Star Wars, before the movie was Star Wars,
right,
and before we actually had a policy. So I fell in love with the belief that, you know, to create a capability to shoot down nuclear ICBM was the future and was the way to make the world a better place.
Wow, that's incredible. That's incredible. And so all of this happened while you're at USC.
Well, it also happened when I played for the Niners.
I got
drafted in the Niners, but I worked on in my offseason for Lockheed Martin, which is right next to the 49er facility, and continued with my missile defense advocacy and involvement through, I think, two presidents, George Bush Sr., after Ronald Reagan, and continued that over my years.
Wow. Well, Riki, outside, let me ask you this. All right, so does that consume, is that your day-to-day right now? Are you involved in football in any way, or is this right now missile defense?
That is my job. I also have a charity, inner-city charity around the country that's, you know, over 10 years old. And obviously my son plays for the New York Giants. So I do get involved with that, and I'm a very strong alumnus of USC. So those are my two outlets, basically, on football.
Wow, that's incredible. So your son's playing with the Giants. How's he doing over there? What do you think about the way that they're kind of reshaping in the direction of the club? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think, you know, a couple things. I mean, I think they don't have a defense. I mean, I think that's probably the biggest problem they have right now. They can't stop anybody. But, I think that they gave a shot to Manning, and he can read. His arm's still good, but he's not the gamer that's been able to convert, where a young kid would take a lot more risk than he would. And I think this is a positive move for the Giants, and to have this first start for Daniel Jones away, not in New York, is something everybody's excited about, being 0-2. I don't know. Right. I don't know much about being 0-2. I didn't have that.
Listen, it's not whether you're 0-2, but your future is on the field. I mean, look, you've got a great running back. You get yourself a high IQ quarterback that comes from a great quarterback system, when you say, with David Cutcliffe, right? And so you've got a
great situation. Yeah, and what's even better is that they've shored up their offensive line. The offensive line is very good. So they made some big additions over this last offseason. I mean, the pocket is there. So the quarterback's not going to be crushed like most rookie quarterbacks that go into high draft pick teams that don't have offensive line. This one, I think, he's going to be protected, and he's got a running back that's the best in the game. So they got to work those combos off.
Yeah, I think a lot of the Giants alumni are very excited about the future for the Giants. A couple of those guys are friends of the Sports Circus, and we had those conversations, and they're not even waffling on the idea of this is the direction the Giants are going, and the feedback has been very good. So to our audience over on the East Coast, a big round of applause for the way the Giants are being handled right now. I think they're going in the right direction.
Yeah, everybody's doubted that first-round pick of the quarterback. I mean, everybody, the entire nation, sports nation, did. And then you saw the kid play, and, you know, as he did, his ability to read and throw in the preseason was unmatched. I mean, I think he was the best quarterback and out of all the rookies this year. So you've got a lot of positive expectations for him. Again, he's a young kid. He's going to make mistakes. He's going to throw a pick or two, but he's also going to be able to run for first downs and do some things that Eli couldn't do at this stage of game.
Right, and he certainly will scramble. And let's face it, you know, Eli's been beaten up and so forth over his career, and he's not really fleet of foot in the first place, but now he's lesser. So I think having Daniel Jones in there, give this kid a shot. I think he's going to be just fine. He'll be able to sit back in that pocket. He's not going to get beat up like Troy Aikman when Aikman came into the league with a very, very bad offensive line. Folks, listen, we're going to be back here in just a few minutes with three-time Super Bowl champion Riki Ellison, San Francisco 49ers, and the University of Southern California. Big ups to you over there, Riki. Back here in a few minutes on the Circus. Don't go anywhere.
Following is a sample from the Sports Circus.
Big Billy here.
here, he certainly knows something about making things difficult on the competition.
God, he's a punisher.
Yeah, he just break the ribs.
Yeah,
just, you know, I still haven't broke someone's collarbone yet in a boxing match, and that's my goal. I want to put somebody in the shoulder.
There's time, Bronco.
I want to put somebody in the shoulder.
You got your bucket list
snap.
Over here of pain.
Yeah, bucket list of pain.
I haven't broken somebody's collarbone. I've broken everything else.
Which reminds me, I was thinking the reason he probably doesn't wear anything when it's cold outside is he figures he'll just grab some nerd and squeeze him real hard and squeeze the warmth out of him.
Squeeze the warmth out of him.
That's a great statement. I have not broke someone's collarbone in the ring yet.
I've never heard that before.
I have not.
Is there a reason you said in the ring?
I can't wait.
Is it that you've broken collarbones just outside of the ring?
You did catch that, right? He said in the ring.
Yeah, exactly. He got him on the curtain. He got him on the edge of the ring and broke his collarbone.
I had to get Sal's name right.
Well, that never happened.
Sal the floor sweeper. That's his new name.
Sal the bookkeeper. Hey,
yeah, but even my name, even my last name.
Add that one to the bank, you know?
But no, Alicia, you even got my last name wrong. That's why I said my name.
I know it starts with
bleeding.
A V. It starts with a V.
He said a V. Really? Quick, where's the punch sound? 400 punches.
Here's the punch sound.
Right, exactly. He was he almost knocked out the microphone.
Alicia, that's why they have cue cards, baby. So don't let the name bother you. Just bring a cue card with you next time.
Yeah, but people can't read my name off a cue card.
Or change your name to Joe Smith or something. Jeez, make it easy.
Yeah.
Because the concept on that was that during I throw a flag downfield for DPI, so
how
to speak.
How far could you throw a flag? What's your record for throwing a flag?
Well, you know what people don't realize.
I know there's beanbags or something.
There's beanbags, marks the spots. It flags. You've got a little sand in it too, and you roll it up to a little ball to try to get to the
record spot.
You know, people think that you're throwing it a huge distance. You don't have to throw it a huge distance. You just got to get it on the right line.
But do they have like a punt passing kick for flags?
No. but you can throw it 15, 20, 22 yards pretty easy. You know, you can throw it pretty good to get it to the spot.
Have you ever thrown a flag at a player out of frustration?
No. I'll tell you what I did do. Years ago, when I was in high school ball, we used to wear the flag in our back pocket. Most officials wear it down in the front. Yeah, yeah. And I went to throw the flag, and at that time, we didn't have all the official supplies like you have now. I used to go to the hardware store and get a fishing weight to put in the yellow flag.
He went to the hardware store.
Yeah.
Fishing weight.
Imagine how old I am.
You can see how well the NFL really pays well, don't they?
So I had this weight in my flag, and it was in the back, and I was on the wing, and I went to throw it, and it got caught in the back of my pants, and I swung it. Swung it like this, and it went across, hit the kid in the helmet. Kid looked at me and said, "Now, don't go off sides again." You know, you got to try to cover yourself. But as you guys know, years ago.
Focusing on Rusty again, you know, celebration, come on, they have, like, cut that down. They're throwing a flag for guys celebrating. You know what would be great? What if somebody goes ahead and gets a touchdown? They got to, and then in order to not be penalized, they run it to the ref, and the ref does a celebration. That would be awesome. How about the ref? How about Rusty?
You stayed on theme, Lenny.
Rusty going ahead, winding it up. Throwing it down.
Boy, you just won't get off of us. Do you want the lights on or off at that time when we do?
It's a different set of lights for
that. But you know, you talk about celebration, boy, it leaves so much to the imagination on what you're going to penalize and whatnot. I think guys should be happy, great, and everything, but you know, they call it long drawn out, choreographed, and et cetera.
You're supposed to act like you've been there.
Lou Holtz made that statement years ago, act like you've been there before.
That's right. Don't
you
be
know,
a punk.
Score. Put the ball down, give it to the referee, you know, and I don't even care if you slam it down, but you don't have to dance. You don't have to call your mom on the phone. You don't have to go hug you upright. You know, come on, guys. Just, you know.
But the goofiest thing that we ever did was they filled the swimming pool full of Jell-O, and people could pay to watch Gary and I dive into this pool of Jell-O. And he and I raised $100,000 doing that.
That's hilarious.
That was the goofiest thing I've ever done.
I love that. And, you know, at least when you go underwater, you can actually eat Jell-O.
That's right. That's right.
Can you actually swim in Jell-O?
You actually could because it's so soft in texture that you actually could.
That's ridiculous.
That's funny. Jesus. Probably the craziest Bill Parcells moment was one day we were getting our butts kicked. I think it might have been Philadelphia. We came in at halftime, and the room was quiet. The room was stoked quiet. Guys were mad. You know, what what's going on? And Parcells comes in the locker room, and he has a garbage can full of garbage. And he takes the garbage can, and he dumps it in the middle of the meeting at halftime. And the guys look at each other, and we go, what the hell is that about? The next thing you know, because that's what you guys are playing like. And I might as well leave you right there with it. That was a quietly kept Parcellsism.
Please visit www.thesportscircus.com for a complete list of featured guests and previous episodes.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal. This segment is brought to you by Cali Vegas, helping people just like you create and host your very own radio, TV, or multimedia talk show. Cali Vegas can help you with everything you need to get out of sitting in hours of traffic like you're probably doing right now and host your very own talk show in your very own studio. Call Cali Vegas at 949-445-1119. That's 949-445-1119. Again, 949-445-1119. 1119 or visit them at calivegas.com. That's calivegas.com and tell them the Sports Circus sent you. And a big welcome back to everybody listening on iHeartRadio, Spotify, and those watching us on AMP TV and KHMP right here in Las Vegas. And, of course, a big welcome back to our listeners on our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates here with three-time Super Bowl champion Riki Ellison, and national champion from the University of Southern California, and also a big guy in the missile defense world. That's really intriguing. I know a lot of people have asked me about this, gotten some messages, Riki, but I have to ask you this. Is the missile defense world right now, for you personally, is that bigger than anything that you've ever done in your career?
I would say yes, absolutely.
All right, that's the right answer, of course.
We're talking about defending 300 million people here in the United States from North Korea.
That's right.
North Korea's got capability to strike the United States today.
We
have capability here that we've had to fight and get in place up in Alaska. We got 44 $80 million interceptors apiece sitting up there.
Wow. No kidding. 44 $80 million. Wow. That's a big number.
Interceptors. 40 of them are in Fort Greeley, Alaska, and 4 of them are out in Vandenberg, California, at the air base there. So we got the 40 up by the North Pole because North Korea's shots are going to come over the pole.
Right over the top.
And we have opportunity to have a, you know, look, shoot, to shoot a couple rounds at each one of them that would fire across. So that's been big. We had a big test in March of this year. We did a salvo shoot to test that system and successfully intercept a target missile.
No kidding. Hey, so I'm gonna switch gears on you, and I'm gonna ask you a little bit about a place that I've been to as well. A little place called Christchurch,
New Zealand. You're gonna take me back to my roots, where I was born.
Yeah, man. Tell everybody how you went from driving on the one side of the road to the other side of the road.
I had a very fortunate upbringing. I did grow up a little bit in Christchurch, had a year or two over in Singapore, and then came back, and my mother got a teaching scholarship at USC in 1968. So I came to Los Angeles in 1968 and fell in love with USC, basically.
Right. And I ask you about the South Island of New Zealand. I did a little bit of work down there, a little beachfront development down there, really cool stuff. Did a little traveling, of course.
I think the South Island of New Zealand is like California in 1950.
Right.
In that type of mentality. It's got everything you want. Beaches, skiing, climate, and no people. No people. It's like California with no people.
Right. Beautiful. It's also the adventure capital of, and I would say arguably, of a greater part of the world too. I mean, extreme sports, left, right, and center. That's a cool place. I took my father jet boating there. You know, I bunch you there.
On the Shout Over River? Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, man, it was
incredible. You know, my great-grandfather found the biggest piece of gold in the history of New Zealand on that river.
What?
Back in the late 1800s.
Excellent. That's very exciting.
Him and his, you know when the gold striking that was happening in California in the 1850s, there was also gold to be found in New Zealand in that same time frame. And he was a young kid, 19, 20 years old, trying to be rich. And his dog, him and his dog crossed this river. The one you're talking about, Shout Over, they were good swimmers. And his dog got washed down the stream, and he chased his dog about a half mile down. And when the dog got out on a piece of rock in the middle of the stream, he was full of gold. And right below that, he found, a couple hundred ounces or so forth of gold right there.
Holy smokes.
The rock is still there. It's called Quarry Rock.
Holy crap, man. That's some serious coin.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was serious coin, and he was able to put my grandfather in the best schools in New Zealand. And my grandfather's brother, my great uncle, is Tom Ellison, who was the first New Zealand All Black captain of New Zealand in 1889.
No kidding.
Where they toured the world. And as I don't know if you know, but the All Blacks are probably the most winningest organization in the world. That's the gold standard.
Yeah, it's certainly the gold standard.
Right.
Tell everybody about the All Blacks in case they've been living under a rock, like this guy that's sitting across the table from me.
Well, before American football, I think, rugby was the team sport that was developed basically to train soldiers to fight. And this game is sort of like kill the guy with the ball when you were in grade school.
Love that.
No forward passing, a very 15-on-15 game that was developed by Britain and the colonists. And New Zealand, for whatever reason, fell in love with this sport, and the sport is the number one sport in that country of 4 million people. And the kids, like our kids, play baseball when they're when they're very young. They play rugby there. And New Zealand has been the world dominant power in rugby. And they've won the last couple World Cups. There's an upcoming World Cup starting off, I think, next week in Japan. And they are world famous. They all wear black jerseys with a silver fern, which my granduncle developed that uniform and that logo. And they do the haka, which is a Maori war chant before each match to the opposing side. It's very ferocious, and that is also world famous.
There's a movie about it too, as well, right?
Yeah, I think there might be, but they're hot. They're the ones. They're the favorites again this year to win the World Cup.
Yeah, that's good stuff. So that haka,
let's
go to that.
Yeah, I think we got a little trouble over here because I think the University of Utah and I think a couple of universities tried to imitate that a couple of years ago, and the country of New Zealand sued them or went after them for using that haka. So it's a very New Zealand thing.
This is it. Here we go. They got the whole stadium going.
That is it.
So, let me ask you this.
Ricky, do you know that chant?
Can you do it for us?
I have the haka, absolutely. The old school one, not the new one. I think they've developed that into new different variants. But if you go back in the day, back in the 1800s, they were cannibals. So if you were beaten in a fight, you were eaten.
You weren't just beaten, you were eaten.
You understand the motivation?
Oh, yeah, man. Or can you do
all right,
it
so
for
that's
us?
What this is about right there. That's why they've got that frenzy, and they get into a frenzy because that's how they play. That's how they fought each other.
So and we're going to eat you chant.
If you get beaten, we're going to eat your ass. That's right. And they
can you do it for us?
Part spot, if you would be faster or quicker. Can what?
Riki, can you do it for us? We've got like a minute.
I just do a line. It starts, you know, kamate, kamate, kora, kora. That means life, life, death, death. That's the start of it.
You're going down.
I'm Mario, guys. I can do this. I am not, you know. I get away with it because I'm Mari. I'm a quarter Mari. So.
All right, well, come on, yeah, man. That's family, only a little bit. Give me more than life, life, death, death. Come on, man.
I'm going to leave it like that because I don't want to offend people and I don't want to pronounce it incorrectly.
Come on, man. We're already talking about missile defense and crap like that. Give me a break.
And I, you know, they're already giving me a hard time because I'm American because I put pads on when I tackle people. So I already have a really, you know, tough reputation down in New Zealand because they don't wear pads, man.
I
they
know.
Jump they, on me they, for wearing pads in our sport for, you know, putting pads and helmets on and this and that and having eight referees and rugby has one on the right. field. There's a different game, different culture.
For sure. Well, pretty soon they're going to be carrying flags in the NFL, the players, that is.
There's no helmets anyway out there in rugby, but there's about to be I don't know, maybe we should just go back to the leather helmets.
That's what I keep saying. Let's go back to the leather hats. So people aren't using their head as a weapon, and then we could just let the boys get out there and play, kill the guy with the ball.
Hey, guys, the rugby guys that don't have helmets are getting concussions too. Let's not fool ourselves. Anybody that's tackling something or having your head, which is in water, hit the ground is going to bounce inside your brain. Your brain's going to bounce on your wall. So
I
don't – leather helmet or non-helmet, you're still getting concussions. Unless you are not going to fall or have your head have contact with something else,
that's for sure.
I'm upset about that too because I think the press is overblowing it, and anybody that plays football, you know, is considered mentally retarded because we're mentally damaged, and that's not right. That's not right at all. Certainly, there's a minority of guys that have concussions and are not all right, but the majority of us are functional human beings.
Now, folks, we're going to be back here with Riki Ellison here at the Sports Circus and all of our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates in just a few moments. Don't go anywhere. Lots more to come. Here we go.
Are you a small business owner or pursuing the dream of starting your own company? Do you know where to start or how to grow that existing business? The American Business Trust Company has the answers you need. The American Business Trust Company can help you start up with capital, business strategy, sales, and marketing, and establish your company with a physical location or an online presence on the internet. You decide. You bring the idea. Then American Business Trust can help with the rest. For a free evaluation, visit them online at abtrustco.com. That's abtrustco.com. Or call them at 657-600-1876. That's American Business Trust Company. 657-600-1876. Call them today. They'll help your business right away. That's American Business Trust Company. Online at abtrustco.com. American Business Trust Company. Are you a small business owner or pursuing the dream of starting your own company? Do you know where to start or how to grow that existing business? The American Business Trust Company has the answers you need. The American Business Trust Company can help you start up with capital, business strategy, sales, and marketing, and establish your company with a physical location or an online presence on the internet. You decide. You bring the idea. Then American Business Trust can help with the rest. For a free evaluation, visit them online at abtrustco.com. That's abtrustco.com. Or call them at 657-600-1876. That's American Business Trust Company. 657-600-1876. Call them today. They'll help your business right away. That's American Business Trust Company. Online at abtrustco.com. American Business Trust Company.
Do you own a timeshare? Well, face the facts. You made a mistake. You made a bad purchase. A timeshare is not an investment. It's a money pit that continues forever. If you use your timeshare, that's great. But if you don't and you want to legally get out of your contract, call my friends right now at the Timeshare Exit Hotline. They're an experienced team of lawyers who help good people like you get out of a timeshare contract that they just don't want. Don't throw away your money on maintenance fees. Use it for things you really want. We can help you end your timeshare contract and stop the money drain immediately. If you're ready to move on with your timeshare, call our team right now.
Cancel your timeshare now with a free call. 800-741-9557. 800-741-9557. 800-741-9557. That's 800-741-9557.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal. This segment is brought to you by Legal Shield, providing legal protection and peace of mind. Legal Shield can help with traffic tickets, texting and driving, DUIs, court appearances, estate planning. Even if you played on a rugby field and you were beaten and eaten, call Legal Shield if you're still around. They may be able to help. 213-245-1305. That's 213-245-1305. Again, 213-245-1305. Or visit them at nocourt.us and tell them the all black team sent you. And a big welcome back to everybody listening in on iHeartRadio, Spotify, and our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates from Honolulu all the way to New York and Boston. We added Boston recently and a bunch of points in between. We're here in Las Vegas and we're here with three-time Super Bowl champion Riki Ellison, also national champion from the University of Southern California. Thanks for joining us again.
You're welcome. We're in it.
All right. That's good stuff. I love the bite sound because it's you're beaten and eaten. I can't get away from that. That's the funniest thing that I can actually think of just from a visual standpoint.
It's real motivation. It is real motivation. The tribe I was from, which is the Nahutahu, which is the South Island, never gotten beaten.
Riki, here it is. I found it. Here's the Haka versus Tonga. You got to translate for us. Here it goes.
He's calling everyone to order.
Okay.
Bringing the spirits in.
Why do they stick their tongue out?
They're all there.
That means you're going to get eaten. That's all
there
I
you go,
about.
Guys. Right there. Kamate, kamate. Right there.
That means we're going to eat you?
You know what it means. No, that's death.
That's all it means. It just says we're going to eat
baby. You. You got a choice. Living or dying, right there.
Really?
That's what they're calling the other team out. They're calling them out right there.
Holy smokes!
Did they cook them first, or are they just?
Oh, do they like them like sashimi style?
Yeah, they cook them.
Really? Do they put them on a rotisserie? And kind of, you know, sing kumbaya in
front of
the fire?
It's kind of a lot of fire.
Oh. So, all right, so we have a rotisserie, a human rotisserie. The whole team is going to get cooked and eaten, and that's the end of that. So what happens when you run out of teams? I mean, I guess you are technically the world champion, right? I mean, it seems as if there's nobody else to play. I mean, you've eaten everybody. I guess you truly are the world champion.
Well, you look at them, they get possessed. So if you look at the guys when they're doing that, their eyes go back into their head, their tongues come out.
Yeah, why
it's
the tongue
very
come out?
Spiritual. They go into a trance. It's a trance. It's pretty wild.
Riki, why do they have the tongues out? What's the significance of that?
That's the spirit. That's the you're flexing out your spirit, and you're true to your being. And you're ready to taste them. You ready to taste of that haunted over there?
There's still people. There's still tribes that actually eat people out there. So.
Yeah, I think they do that.
I don't know. Maybe some in Papua New Guinea. Not in New Zealand anymore.
No,
maybe
man.
Out there in Papua New Guinea.
Yeah, I think it's New Guinea that does it. But jeez.
Well, the whole Pacific. You know, I mean, they ate Captain Cook too when the Hawaiians ate Captain Cook. I mean, Tahitians eat people. I mean, the Fijians eat people. It's just the way it is. Well, they get tired of seafood.
Yeah, I was going to say, when you're tired, either you can't catch any more fish or you just need a different taste, let's go for something maybe a little beefy type. I don't know. I mean, I can't imagine what that's going to be like, but...
Human is good.
How would you know? This guy's like, well, I don't know. Folks, we're here with three-time Super Bowl champion Riki Ellison. All right, so, hey, Riki, you have a foundation, or you were telling me you have another... I think you said this.
Yeah, I got a charity. I got a youth impact program. I developed out of South Central LA, obviously out of USC, back in 2006, I think. So it's pretty cool, man. I'm bridging that gap between the inner city and the institution in the inner city, where we have our social issues, a lot of social issues and anxiety between the haves and the have-nots. So this is something I really went after.
Riki, let me ask you this. Just because you mentioned that, now, you may remember a couple of years ago there was a fund, I think about $87 million was established by the National Football League, and that was, I guess that was supposed to help a similar situation, right? And I believe Anquan Boldin stopped playing for the Buffalo Bills so he could be a part of this. Do you know anything about that particular purpose or cause or organization or use of funds?
I don't know about that NFL use of funds. I do know about the TBI. I know I helped that with the commissioner, with our owner, the 49er owner, Mr. York, Dr. York, who is the only doctor of any of the owners. And that was, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago or earlier than that, when we were getting traumatic brain injuries in the military on the blast fragment zones, IEDs. And we brought the West Point, and we brought, at West Point, we brought the chief of the U.S. Army with the commissioner, and they created a fund to explore commonality between concussions caused in the battlefield versus concussions on the playing field. And that was that's a study I know.
It's really two of the same, because the battlefield and the battlefield, they really are, whether it's on the gridiron or really out on that battlefield, because you're getting your head banged around to one degree or another, even the training side of it too. Wouldn't you agree with that? And I'm talking about the military training side of it, because you are.
Yeah, no, but the interesting thing, just like the football field, you got guys in the same fragmentation zone that don't get concussed. You got the guys on the same field that get hit maybe the same way, don't get concussed. So it comes back to genetics at some point. Just like you can run a 40 faster than somebody else can, or you can lift more weights than somebody else can, you can sustain a concussion better than somebody else. Because from my perspective, that's what happens out there. I mean, there are conditions and so forth that cause that or maybe not cause that, but there's some similarities. And one of the most interesting things that the benefit from the IED concussions was these guys were putting them in planes, and that was the worst thing you could do after you're concussed is get them in a plane. And they found that out. The Army found that was the worst thing you could do. And you can remember when NFL teams play, they get on planes after they play the game and fly home.
Right. Yeah.
And I think that policy has come and take that you wouldn't get on a plane. There's a lot of interesting research is going on between the two and checking if your guy can go out to battle or not, if he's concussed or not, or go out and play again if he's concussed or not, and those checkdowns to go through that, and then getting more safety and getting more gear or so forth on that, and then the rehabilitation of guys that have got PTSS and have got those issues. I mean, the Veterans Associations here, they've done some remarkable stuff here in Walter Reed on this.
Yeah. Yeah, I
and those two things need to merge, I think, more than they are.
Yeah, I was going to say, too, Riki, when it comes to what you were just saying, more safety when it comes to the helmets, too. It looks like the NFL is going to go ahead and open up the forum to different companies to kind of go and help them develop a new helmet to prevent concussions. $3 million to the person that can kind of design that.
Yeah, but see, I mean, you can go so far with that, but you're still going to have your brain floating in water, hitting a hard surface, no matter how hard that surface is going to bounce, whether it's the ground or not. I don't think you can prevent your brain from bouncing inside the water that it's between it, the water and the skull. You can't. I don't know how you, unless you don't hit people.
Yeah, that is true. I was going to say.
I'm not a scientist. I'm just telling you.
There's impact in there.
Yeah, there's impact.
No matter what, yeah. Riki, you're right. There's going to be impact, so that means the brain is going to move. Mm-hmm. When the brain hits the wall, you're concussed. Yeah. How about those soccer players? All the soccer players, they don't realize heading the ball all the time. Every time they do that, they're essentially concussing themselves.
Yeah,
but again, I think there's genetics. And then if you're looking about genetic engineering, where there are people that can sustain those, do you use those genetics to leverage that and counter that? Do you just let people with certain genetics play the game or not? I mean, there's a lot of questions here, and there's a lot of subtleties that, you know, maybe you can't do this in this society. You can't genetically create super soldiers or super players. I think going to that extent, because we have values and structure in our society, but the Chinese don't. The Chinese are creating genetic soldiers, doing stuff that we're not doing, cloning and doing all that. But, I mean, that, you know, we're in a world where the computer and the processing units are really pushing the information to be able to do things that we've never done before.
Right. All right, folks, listen, we're going to be back here for our final segment with Riki Ellison, three-time Super Bowl champion, in just a few moments. Don't go anywhere. Lots more to come here on The Circus. Back in a few minutes.
I don't know what the big deal about Cracker Jack is. Did you ever go and buy a pack of Cracker Jack thinking you'd get a prize and find no prize in the box? Here's the pitch. That might not sound important to some people, but when you're a little kid, especially from humble origin, and they cheat you out of a prize, there's a bouncing ball. Second baseman has the Barbary over to first. It's hard to think in laudatory terms of the product.
I take it there was an occasional box of Cracker Jacks that found no prizes for the little Harry Carey many years ago.
You got that right. And boy, when a box of Cracker Jack to me meant a lot of money. Here's a pitch, bounce foul. That's the most asinine marketing I've ever heard of. One ball, one strike. These guys say, well, you sing about Cracker Jack. I said that I only sing it because it's in the song. Here's a pitch, foul back. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised, even to this day, some youngsters who buy a box of Cracker Jack don't find a prize in the box. One ball, two strikes, two out. Well, if you're going to talk about our congressman being crooked, here's a pitch foul out of play. Why not talk about commercial products that don't do what they represent to do? Can't beat fun at the old ballpark, friends. Hi, pop fly. That one be a home run in a phone booth.
There's a drive way back. It might be. It could be. And it is. This crowd is wild.
You're listening to one radio station in the heart of Pasig City. This is 104.1 Best Radio FM. Stay tuned.
You're tuned into Boston's best for dance and R&B. Keep it locked to Mix 96.
Hey, everybody. This is Barry Katz from the Industry Standard Podcast, and you're listening to the Sports Circus with Sal Tuzzolino.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal. A big welcome back for everybody listening in on iHeartRadio, Spotify, and our CBS, NBC, and Fox Sports affiliates from coast to coast, and also those watching on AMP TV as well as KHMP right here in Las Vegas. Folks, make sure to check out the Sports Circus for our upcoming guests, our prior guests. Listen to the podcast. Check out the store. Pick up some swag. And go to our page for our partners and check out the charities and other organizations that we work with. Lots of great organizations represented there. And make sure you follow us on social media. That would be on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Instagram, we are TSC Show. On Facebook and Twitter, we're either at the Sports Circus or just the Sports Circus. And just make sure to check us out and like us and follow us. We're here with special guest, three-time Super Bowl champion, Riki Ellison from the San Francisco 49ers. And, of course, national champion with the USC Trojans. All right, Riki, let me ask you the Swiss Army knife question. You know, every team has their Swiss Army knife. Go back to when you played. What was the Swiss Army knife on your team as an offensive player and a defensive player? Give me both sides of it. Was it maybe the fullback? Was it the free safety? What was it on either side?
I think... For us, it was the elephant man. It's, you know, the elephant position, which is that pass rusher. We put the pass rusher down. And the reason why it's called elephant, it's still called elephant today, is because of Charles Haley, because he was so damn ugly. That movie, The Elephant Man, was there. We called him the elephant. And that's true today. So that was the fourth linebacker going down, and that's the pass rusher. And that came from Fred Dean, Hall of Famer, prior to, you know, Charles replaced Fred. But that position, the 49ers had that. I had no idea why San Diego let Fred Dean go. And Bill Walsh made him, coming off that corner, unblockable. And then you saw Lawrence Taylor follow that lead, and it went on from there. But that was, I think, one of the big evolutions that happened in my era for that fourth linebacker to go down on the ground off the weak side and put the pressure on the left tackle.
Okay, so on the offensive side of the ball, what position, typically, it doesn't matter what team it is, what position do you believe is sort of the Swiss Army knife on the offense?
Well, it's the tight end. It's the tight end because in the way they're using it today, and my son's in that, but being able to offset those formations, where the runner goes and unbalance the defense. And the defense is adjusting to try to put their best pass rusher over that tight end. And that tight end is also an extra blocker that goes in. So they leverage that quite a bit, as you see, especially with teams with good running back. I think the slot receiver may be the next one, but that's a pass-happy deal on that aspect.
Right. You know, that tight end position, I kind of wish that we had the old I formation. We have a blocking back. We have a full back. Let the tight end either be that blocking back or that second or third option. But really what we're seeing largely these days, because we're not really seeing that I formation or the old pitch to Walter Payton or Roger Craig from your team. Roger Craig, by the way, a big friend of the Sports Circus. But the idea of – Roger's a great guy, isn't he? Just a tremendous human.
I mean, Roger. His nickname was Catfish. Look at his face. You'll know why we call him Catfish.
Exactly. I'll have to tell him that next time I talk to him. But the idea of having – that traditional offense. When I think of the Swiss Army knife, exactly, I was going to say the tight end, but in yesteryear, maybe.
Yeah, but you see it with a great running back. You're going to see it with teams. You're going to see with teams that have good running backs. They're going to have the two tight end. They're going to put them in the backfield with the lead back. That's not there. What the NFL is always an evolution of a new system that nobody can beat. And then they get to that system, and then they go back to the running system that breaks that pass-happy system. And we start the evolution over again. So you're seeing some teams now. I mean, Kansas City is leading that charge in that wide-open offense.
Yeah.
But going back to beating that is ball control and having a defense and having an offense that could control that ball. And if you can control the ball by short passing game or running game and keep the possession, it goes back to that, I think. But
yeah, watching the I like the running game establishing the passing game. It doesn't matter which way you look at it. If you're top heavy in one, you're going to have to balance it out with the other side at some point. But really opening up the passing game starts with what? A solid running game, right? So why wouldn't the team...
Right. Or you have that. A brilliant coach like Bill Walsh with timing routes that nobody can stop. I mean, that's the other, a three-step drop and decision-making that quick. But most of our quarterbacks don't do it, except for Tom Brady, who gets that ball out of his hand in under 3 seconds. That is so hard to stop, guys. When routes are being run in 3 seconds with timing and ball's already out before the cut, you can't defend that. It's
impossible because you have to be able to act instead of react, and you have to anticipate the route and actually know the route in the first place or know the formation.
But the receiver already knows he's reacting off of you, and he's got two-way or three-way route with that quarterback. I mean, if it's coached correct, it's virtually unstoppable unless you can get penetration on that three-step drop. And there's a lot of quarterbacks that can't do that, that can't make that decision.
Right. It's Jerry Rice with all those yards after catch. So he's going to take two steps, boom, he's got the ball. Now Jerry Rice, being a track star, is gone. That's the end of that. Good luck catching him. I think the only guy that could catch him would be Willie Gault.
Right. Yeah, Willie Gault. Willie Gault can't catch the ball.
He never could catch
Jerry,
the ball.
yeah. Funny story. We won't go into there. But,
oh, come on. Leave my beers alone, mister.
Yeah, well, Willie Gould was a hurdler, right? And his eyes bounced when he jumped over the hurdle.
That's right.
Ronnie and those guys, they went after Willie. Woo!
That they did.
All right.
Yeah, I was also going to say, when you were talking about the tight end being the Swiss Army knife, Denver Broncos, I watched them when they had Shannon Sharp. That was an amazing way that they utilized him as a tight end. And was able to not only have him block in there, also put him out there at the slot too, where they actually was able to fake the defenses out because he can run routes as well, and he can block, and he was blocking for a great running back too as well. So
mismatches out there on top of everything as well. It's a great position to play. And I think what they've done is they've evolved it to fullbacks, and most NFL teams don't have fullbacks anymore, and they're carrying three or four tight ends that do that position, that motion position to offset the defense. Yeah. And blitz pick up as well.
You can keep them on the field too. You can adjust them out to the fullback, out to the slot, back to the tight end. You could just keep rotating them without coming off the field for a 2-minute warning. So,
okay, so on the coaching staff, real quick, in our last minute or so, who is the Swiss Army knife of the coaching staff?
Who's the best coach that can... I mean, Belichick's by far the best coach in the NFL.
Your offensive, your defensive, your special teams. I mean, who's the guy that really makes the biggest impact? Go back to your team. Go back to your 49ers. Tell me about the unsung hero in that group.
The defensive coordinator and the defense. Because, you know, offenses are like beautiful women, man. They can run like crazy. And they're the deal when they're on fire, but when they're cold, they are cold. And you got to hang on a defense. You got to hang on, and that's what the 49ers were so great, because we could stop people. That's where Kansas City is not great, because they got a great offense, but they can't stop anybody. And that's the great unsung thing. And then having the complex defenses, our defenses were split zone, man. We had very complex. We were decoying things. We were doing similar things to what the Bill Walsh revolutionary passing offense. We were doing similar things with George Seifert as our defensive coordinator that nobody else was doing. And nobody hears about it because it's all about the offense. Same way with our military, man. It's all about the offense. We spend like 90% of our money on offense.
Wow, that's a great
thing. They get all the same. That's just the way it is.
Ricky, we're in our last 30 seconds. Tell everybody about your social media and your causes real quick before we get out of here. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, my youth impact program, I take inner-city boys off the streets for 2 weeks and put them into the university campuses with the student-athletes and U.S. Marines and the public school teachers. And we go through math, science, English, feed them, and put them on the field. And we have dramatic increases in academics. I mean, dramatic, 20, 30, 40% increases on that. And we change the leadership. And most importantly, we create trust, which is not there, and respect for authority from the inner cities to the big institutions. And we do it real, and we do it over a sustained period of time. And that's leadership development. And I'm going to tell you, America's made of the grit from the inner city, or the grit.
There it is. All right, folks, that's Riki Ellison, three-time Super Bowl champion, San Francisco 49ers. A big welcome, or a big thank you for you joining us today. I'm your Ringmaster Sal, John Tippins, Washington State, Baltimore Ravens. Everybody, we'll see you next time right here on the Circus on your favorite channel. So long, everyone.
Attention business owners, you and your customers are listening to this commercial right now. Face it, every business needs customers, even yours. The Sports Circus is a primetime nationally syndicated program that's carried on ABC, NBC, CNBC, and Westwood One News affiliates, plus CBS, Fox, and NBC Sports affiliates across North America, with coverage from Hawaii to New York. Also, the Sports Circus is available to the 180 million subscribers on iHeartRadio, and the Sports Circus gets about 4 million website visitors per month, which could click through your website and bring sales. The Sports Circus provides great content featuring celebrity guests from sports and entertainment to our audience every weekday, which your company could greatly benefit from by increasing your visibility, foot traffic, eyeballs to your website, and calls from potential customers. Call us right now at 702-799-9935. Again, 702-799-9935, or email us at info@thesportscircus.com. That's info@thesportscircus.com. Drive your sales today by advertising with the Sports Circus.
That's the sound of sizzling, dry-aged USDA Prime Wagyu and Angus steaks from UppercutChops.com. They're best-in-class filet mignons, New York steaks, and the king of all steaks, the tomahawk and cowboy cut ribeyes, are the best in the business. Even their Prime Wagyu burgers will likely be the best you've ever had. Browse the full selection of steaks and chops at UppercutChops.com from the comfort of your home or on your mobile device. UppercutChops.com delivers all-natural, dry-aged USDA Prime Wagyu and Angus steaks and chops directly to your door. Without the hassle of going to the grocery store and fight crowds to pick from a small selection of average and best meats with injected steroids, fillers, and coloring added to look good. Find out what's for dinner at UppercutChops.com or call 702-799-9935. That's 702-799-9935. 702-799-9935. Or make your selection directly at UppercutChops.com.
Oof. Hello, Americans. It's Uncle Sam here. If you owe $10,000 or more in back taxes to the IRS or state, don't worry. I've got important news that may help you negotiate a lower tax bill. In today's economy, the IRS has released a variety of new rules and is offering more flexible terms to help Americans looking to settle their IRS debt. If you apply today, we may be able to lift your wage garnishments and release a freeze on your bank assets or business. Our team of tax professionals can resolve your case and stop collection actions against you. Even if you've been audited or haven't filed a return in years, they can help. Call right now and find out if you qualify to settle your IRS debt for far less than what you owe. Pick up your phone right now and call us for a free $500 IRS tax review. Don't wait. Here's the number.
Don't wait. Call right now. 888-794-1630. 888-794-1630. Write it down. 888-794-1630. Again, for the last time, 888-794-1630. If you're living with diabetes and using insulin, you know the pain of pricking your fingers over and over again. Ouch! Well, by wearing a small remote device called a continuous glucose monitor, or CGM, you can reduce the pain of pricking your fingers. If you administer insulin three or more times per day or use an insulin pump, call now and learn how a CGM can help you.
Painless. No more pricking my finger.
No finger pricks.
Convenience. They delivered it free and they took care of all the paperwork.
You can reduce pain right away. Plus, it's accurate, easy to use, and helps you spend more time in range. And if you have insurance, you can get a new CGM at little or no out-of-pocket cost. Call now and get free shipping of your new CGM. Plus, we'll bill your insurance for you. 800-659-7805. 800-659-7805. 800-659-7805. That's 800-659-7805.